Since the earliest beginnings of civilization, man has used his energy and ingenuity to cultivate the land. From land, and from the rich natural resources it contains, all wealth emerges. We are dependent on the earth for all our needs, for food, for clothing and shelter, for the materials with which we build and manufacture, for the ores and fossil fuels that power our cities and machines, and for the space, the open terrain over which we travel and on which we build. In earlier times, the average man had access to the resources he needed, provided he was willing to use his strength and his wits to make a living. As long as there was still unclaimed space on the face of the earth, no one who was willing to work would lack, at the very least, the barest essentials. But as man advanced, and as the frontiers were appropriated and fenced off, there came a time when the struggle was waged against an adversary far more subtle than raw nature. Human nature. Now, our rural areas are dominated by huge corporate agricultural conglomerates who have all but driven the small farmer out of the picture. If he's lucky, the average person might be able to hold on to a small piece of land and break his back to squeeze out a living. Or maybe he'll work for the big corporations, making somebody else rich while he struggles to make ends meet. Or maybe he'll pack up and try his luck in the cities, where maybe he'll find work and maybe he won't, because the economy is tight and just about everybody is cutting production and laying off their employees. Where maybe he'll have a decent place to live and maybe he won't, because slumlording and speculation and the overall lack of intelligent urban design have turned our cities into a disgrace. Where maybe he'll make it, and maybe he won't. Why is it that today, when we have at our disposal the greatest technology in the history of civilization, and the capital and the intelligence to put it to work, we are plagued by unprecedented unemployment, inflation, economic hardship, and crime? Why is it that the further we progress, the more we are afflicted by poverty? Access is the answer. If given free access to resources with tools and knowledge of how to make it work, there are few people on earth who wouldn't jump at the opportunity to make a productive, creative contribution to society, to earn their living and enjoy the fruits of their labor. But the access is not there. A large percentage of both urban and rural land and resources are laying idle, concentrated in the hands of a few powerful entrepreneurs who find it more profitable to speculate than to produce. And a great portion of the wealth that is produced in America is claimed by the least productive element of society, those who hold land and resources out of production and out of the reach of working people. People who need only access to put these resources to use for themselves and for the community. There are old ideas that are coming back. Ideas that are reflected in the writings of many of the greatest statesmen and thinkers who laid the foundations of these ideas on democracy and free enterprise. Men like John Locke and Thomas Paine, Adam Smith and John Stuart Mill. It is a simple, obvious fact that men did not make the earth. That men cannot create land and natural resources. And therefore, no man can claim to own nature. Properly applied, this basic truth can solve our problem of access to economic opportunity. In the Lincoln-Douglas debates, and later in his years as president, Abraham Lincoln eloquently presented the case against human slavery. How can one person presume to own and control the life of another human being? But Lincoln's insight did not stop at slavery. He understood the many forces of oppression to which masses of men are everywhere subjected, and he saw the absurdity of treating the planet as private property.
The land, the earth God gave man for his home, sustenance, and support, should never be the possession of any man. An individual or company or enterprise requiring land should hold no more than is required for their home and sustenance, and never more than they have in actual use. All that is not so used should be held for the free use of every family.
Lincoln was never able to realize his goal of land and tax reform. The evil of slavery came first. But others after him picked up the thread of the remedy. Out of the Western expansion that followed the Civil War years, there arose a man who developed a carefully worked out plan to cure the spreading disease of economic injustice. Henry George was a man of precise vision, a journalist and social philosopher who viewed the Industrial Depression of America in the 1870s as the result of this one fundamental mistake, the institution of private exploitation of land and natural resources, as distinguished from capital. As though he had walked the streets of the future, Henry George foresaw a time when the American frontier would be exhausted, when the victims of economic injustice would no longer be able to strike out and claim new land or build a life by the sweat of their brow. He saw the inexorable trend towards a time when the immense natural resources of America would be concentrated in the hands of the least productive element of society, at the expense of the productivity of mankind, who can barely fulfill his most basic desires. In his monumental work entitled Progress and Poverty, Henry George described the nature of man as an economic animal. He will invariably try to fulfill his desires with the least possible effort. And to do so, he will tend to monopolize the natural opportunities that surround us all, and then charge his fellow man for their use. To this basic injustice, George proposed a remedy.
We must make land available to all mankind at all times.
But though he was not afraid to dream, the author of Progress and Poverty was first and foremost a practical man. Anticipating the objections to such a radical proposal from both the large landholder, who might stand to lose from any change in the status quo, and the small land user, who is never comfortable with sudden change, George outlined a clear and workable method to move smoothly toward a solution. It is not necessary, he wrote, to confiscate land. It is only necessary to collect community-created rental values called economic rent. The idea was not a new one. America had been founded by men who envisioned the emerging nation as a land of equal opportunity in this most basic sense. Though they themselves were of the landed aristocracy, our earliest statesmen knew this same truth. Thomas Jefferson.
The earth is given as a common stock for men to labor and to live on.
And Thomas Paine.
Men did not make the earth. It is the value of the improvement only, not the earth itself, that is individual property. Every proprietor owes to the community a ground rent for the land which he holds.
Rents is the key word. Ground rent, said Thomas Paine. Or as Henry George described it, economic rent. To understand just what we mean by economic rent, we must first explore and define the natural process by which man creates wealth. Natural resources are the first of three basic elements required to produce wealth. Land. Land for farming, land for mining, land for business and commerce, land for the recreation and expansion of the spirit. Minerals and timber, ore and fuel, sunshine, untapped sources of energy, water and air and wide open spaces, good soil, poor soil, ocean and desert, the stuff that makes this planet arable, workable, shapeable, and ultimately livable. The raw material that lacks only the intervention of human creative energy and intelligence to become something more than just nature. But though we sometimes speak of a wealth of natural resources, true economic wealth is man-created and requires our second essential element, labor. Human strength and skill. Human energy and effort. Whether we choose to be construction workers, or lab technicians, or tomato pickers, our time and our energy are ours and ours alone. And it is the undeniable right of every person to enjoy the fruit of his or her labor. The tangible, man-created wealth that emerges from our work upon the land can either be consumed or hoarded, or it can be recycled back into productivity. That portion of the wealth that is turned back into the production cycle and used to create more wealth is called capital. Capital, as defined by Henry George, includes all forms of wealth that are in the process of being exchanged, either from one form to another, such as aluminum to be molded into food containers, or from one segment of society to another, such as the tractor trailer that moves the product from manufacturer to seller and from the seller to the buyer. The usual medium of exchange is called money. But the money itself is not capital. The pick and shovel in the hands of labor is capital, as is the wealth used to construct a hydroelectric dam. But the laborer himself is labor and not capital, just as the watershed is only a natural resource, and neither can in any way be said to belong to any man or corporation or public utility. The bulldozer is capital, but not its driver, nor the mountain it moves. Now, we have natural resources, labor, and capital. With these three factors clearly defined, we can begin to understand the underlying confusion in today's economic institutions across the political spectrum. Those who claim to be capitalists on the right, in their prevailing understanding of free enterprise, fail to distinguish between capital and natural resources. Can an individual or a corporation really claim to own a beach, or a river, or a tract of land? Obviously not. The earth and all its riches are the general property of all mankind, and all should have equal access to the land to develop and cultivate for his own needs and the needs of society. The bulldozer, the steel and cement, these are things that rightfully belong in the realm of the private property in our free enterprise system. On the other hand, the socialists or communists on the left make a different mistake. They fail to distinguish between capital and labor. We in the free world clearly understand that no state or corporate entity can own a human being or appropriate the value of his creative energy. Henry George had a clear insight. He saw that of these three factors that combine to produce wealth, only natural resources truly belong to the community as a whole. Capital, and only capital, should be the property of the private sector, and the fruits of labor are the rightful property of the laborers themselves. Let society collect its revenues in the form of rent for the